Hello everyone. Sorry for the slight delay. Welcome to the Future of Food, Agroecology versus Industrial. This is a webinar brought to you by the Hunger Program, Food First, U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance, and the Food Chain Workers Alliance. Welcome, and we have an interesting hour in front of us here, and encourage your participation. That makes a webinar different than just watching a video. So we will have a couple times for you to interact with our presenters.
Hi everyone, my name is Vicki Machado. I am a Food Justice Fellow with the Presbyterian Hunger Program. I am also an environmental organizer for Food and Water Watch, and I am delighted to introduce this webinar today, kicking off the start of World Food Week. So I'll give you a little bit of the format first. We have two really great speakers, Eric Holt-Gimenez and Diana Robinson. And first, Eric will speak, and then we'll have a clip, the importance of urban agroecology and urban homesteading, and then Diana will speak. So before we get into their talks, I'm just going to give you a little bit background information on them. So Eric Holt-Gimenez, PhD, is the Executive Director of Food First, the Institute for Food and Development Policy. He is the editor of the Food Movements Unite, Strategies to Transform Our Food Systems, co-author of Food Rebellions, Crisis, and the Hunger for Justice, and author of Campesino, Voices from Latin America's Farmer to Farmer Movement for Sustainable Agriculture. From 1977 to 1998, Eric worked on the ground in Mexico and Central America with the Campesino movement. He taught development studies at the University of California in Berkeley and Santa Cruz, and for the Boston Honors Program in Global Ecology. So prior to coming to the Food First, he was the Latin America Program Manager for the Bank Information Center. And Diana Robinson is the Campaign and Education Coordinator of the Food Chain Workers Alliance. Diana formerly worked at United Food and Commercial Workers Local 1500, which represents over 23,000 grocery store workers in New York. And at Local 1500, she played dual roles as a worker organizer and the food policy coordinator of the Building Blocks Project for Good Food, Good Jobs, and Good Health. She was a leader of the union's 2011 campaign to organize target workers in Long Island, and she is a member of the Brooklyn Food Coalition Governing Board. Unfortunately, Gary Kenny, the coordinator of the United Church of Canada's food programs, couldn't join us, but we are looking forward to Eric and Diana's talk. So off to you, Eric. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody, or good afternoon. And it's a pleasure and certainly a privilege to be able to talk to you today and launch this week on food. I guess I want to start by quoting somebody else's work, because we're going to be talking about the future of food, and I think we need to know the future. We have to understand the past as well. But Tim Wise had a blog just the other day, and he talked about the conceit of feeding the world, and he basically points out that what we hear more and more is how we have to feed 10 billion people by 2050, and to do that, we've got to increase production by 70 to 100%. And Tim asks, who is this we anyway? Who is this royal we that has to feed the world? Who are we talking about? And to make a long story short, we're talking about industrial agriculture. These are assumptions and projections basically made by industrial agriculture in its different academic and political and technical forms. But where the conceit comes in is that presently industrial agriculture, you know, the very high-end, highly mechanized, highly capitalized agriculture, which we think is so tremendously productive, actually only feeds about 15% of the world's population. And we know this because only about 15% of world food crosses any borders. This globalized, industrialized food system is the one proposing to feed the world. So first we have to ask, well, who's feeding it now? And we find that 85% of the world's food comes from peasant farmers. And most of these farmers happen to be women. So these are the people feeding the world. Now, unfortunately, the 70% of the world's hungry people also happen to be farmers, and most of the hungry people in the world happen to be women and girls. And we also find that, in fact, we produce 1.5 times enough food to feed every man, woman, and child on the planet. In fact, we produce enough food to feed 10 billion a day, and yet we have close to a billion hungry people. So I think we have to, this conceit about feeding the world, I think has to really be recast. I think this is these sort of claims and about feeding the world are really market-based claims. This is about those who feed 15% of the world wanting the market share of those who feed 80% of the world. And why is that? Well, the reason is that we have to be careful not to confuse demand with need. In other words, we have a capitalist food system, and it basically responds to demand, consumer demand, market demand. It doesn't respond to need. So hungry in the world today are the people who are poor and can't afford the food which is being sold. And sometimes that's even the people who produce the food have to sell it and then can't afford to buy it back when they need to eat. So when we talk about the future of food, I think we have to first unpack whose futures are we talking about. Is it the industrial future, or is it the future of the world's 2 billion peasant farmers? So we see a tremendous, what we have is basically a fight over the food system behind the guise of feeding the world. And the way we got to this place, I think, is worth quickly reviewing. In order to determine, you know, where can we go from here, address this issue of, well, will industrial agriculture or will agroecology feed the world? This will be determined on the basis of a huge struggle over the food system. And this struggle has been going on for quite some time, but if we pick it up in the 1960s, we see the first step in this struggle has been the Green Revolution. And the Green Revolution basically extended the industrial form of food production from the global north to the global south. Why did it do that? Well, again, the guise was to feed the world, again, to save the world from hunger. In fact, what had happened was that the agribusiness had saturated the markets in the United States and in Europe. Farmers could no longer consume any more quantities of agricultural inputs. And so these had to be exported in order to increase sales and to expand the market. And to do that, we had to launch a huge campaign called the Green Revolution, which on the face of it, saved a billion people from hunger. Because a tremendous amount of food was produced, and the price of food went down dramatically. However, what behind the scenes, another billion people were shoved into the ranks of the hungry. Because if you look at the figures, if you exempt China from the equation, the Western world basically increased food per capita by about 11%. But it could the number of hungry people also increased by 11%. And who were those hungry people? They were farmers, and it's because the Green Revolution favored larger and more capitalized farmers, and who eventually pushed the smaller farmers off the land. They went up into the agricultural frontier, up into the fragile hillsides, continuing to produce. So you get tremendous, tremendous production worldwide because the area is also increased. And they go into the cities to live in the slums, and they go hungry. And they go hungry on the agricultural frontier as well when they use up the nutrients, and on the hillsides as well when their soils erode. So this model of production, I think, is now being reintroduced, particularly in Africa with the New Green Revolution. In Africa, led by the Gates Foundation and this project called AGRA. The second component of this are the free trade agreements. You hear again and again, what we have to do is introduce the Green Revolution, increase the amount of food we produce, and we need free markets so this food can supposedly move around the world and feed everybody. What this does is, first, it ignores how the Green Revolution also produces hunger by impoverishing farmers, and it also ignores how free trade has impoverished farmers. And I think probably most of the listeners today know the story of the free trade agreements and of how subsidized grain in the north is then dumped into the global south, and the farmers in the global south can't compete and they go out of business. This is what's led, of course, to the tremendous demographic transition. People from the global south going to the cities or going to the global north looking for work because their livelihoods have been destroyed, in large part by the free trade agreements and the Green Revolution in our food system or our corporate food regime. And so what all of these agreements and all of this technology is basically part of what we call the corporate food regime. Think of all of the rules and regulations and institutions which govern global food, and that's the food regime. In other words, that would be the World Bank, the IMF, the USAID, the World Trade Organization, all the free trade agreements, the U.S. Farm Bill, which pretty much determines the price of grain worldwide. All of these things hold in, and increasingly big philanthropy like Bill Gates' foundation. These basically call the shots for the global food regime. Now, and are now proposing to basically take over that other 80-85% of the market, which is presently controlled by the world's smallholders and pastoralists and fishers. So this is basically the battle. And when we look at the question, well, will industrial agriculture or will agroecology feed the world? Why is it being termed like this? And it certainly is. I think there's a tremendous clash between agroecology and industrial agriculture. Technical clash, a social clash, an ideological clash, and certainly an economic clash. And the reason is that agroecology doesn't really provide any market opportunities because it allows farmers to save tremendous amount of money on inputs and whatnot. Agroecology is also knowledge intensive, rather capital intensive, and so it requires a tremendous amount of farmer knowledge. Which is held not just in a farmer's head, but really within the culture of farming and within the larger networks of social organization that one finds in the countryside and in villages and in extended families. Because it is so varied over the different agroecosystems of the planet. It's very site-specific. Whereas industrial agriculture, you really don't need to know as much. You just have to have enough money be able to participate in enough land and access to irrigation and to mechanization in order to take advantage of these tremendous economies of scale. So the big problem here is that industrial agriculture, as proposed by pretty much the corporate food regime, proposes to save the world from hunger by displacing the peasantry and introducing capitalist rationality and industrial rationality into all of the agro-ecosystems of the world. Now, let's just suppose that industrial agriculture succeeds in doing this, in displacing the peasantry. It's got a tremendous amount of support from our governments and from corporations and from big philanthropy. Suppose it does displace the peasantry. Suppose it does industrialize the rest of agriculture around the world, and we have maybe 50,000 highly mechanized farms producing a tremendous amount of food. Now, this wouldn't be terribly sustainable, as we know, because even at present, they use up about 80% of the world's water and something like 20% of the world's greenhouse gases, and it destroys 70% of the world's agrobiodiversity. So how long that would last is unclear. It won't last very long. But suppose they were able to do that. Suppose they were able to produce enough food for everybody on the planet. The big question is, how would people buy this food if you've just destroyed their livelihoods? Where are 2 to 2.5 billion people going to go if you drive them off the land and out of the countryside? We have no new industrial revolution to absorb all of this labor. In fact, by some accounts, the world would have to grow at something like 15% over the next half century to absorb all of these people. Well, that's obviously an impossibility. We're not even growing at 2% now. So I think that the big danger is that the continued spread of industrial agriculture through the free trade agreements and through the new green revolution will cause so much disruption in the countryside and a tremendous social breakdown, and we could expect obviously a lot of struggle, a lot of strife, a lot of unintended consequences, and for all kinds of our social systems, like our health systems, for example. I really don't see a very positive scenario coming out of that, and I don't even think in the end it will be terribly profitable because things are going to be falling apart. I think that important that what agroecology offers is quite a bit in terms of technically and socially, but it also offers a political path towards sort of keeping people on the land and restructuring markets, protecting farmers and local food economies from the global marketplace, which is dominated by the big market players, Cargill and Monsanto, et cetera, et cetera. And the political platform for agroecology is food sovereignty, which is basically the democratization of the food system in favor of the poor. Because when the poor are better off, everybody is better off. And most of the poor today are, much of the poor is in the countryside. So I think I'll leave the discussion there for the moment. I think that if agroecology is going to have a chance, to give us a productive and sustainable and more equitable food systems, we also need to change not just the practices and the technologies, but we need to change the politics. We need to change the corp into a food sovereignty regime. We need to change the rules. We need to change the institutions so that they favor agroecology and food sovereignty rather than the corporate food regime that we have today.
Wonderful, thank you. So next up, I think we will be showing a short clip on urban homesteading and urban agroecology.
Andrew, if I could interrupt you for just a moment, there's no sound on the video for us. There's no sound.
His daughters, a niece, but these days,
we'll try this again.
People are turning to their own backyards to create urban farms. One Southern California family is at the forefront of that movement. Drivers whizzing past on the 210 freeway through Pasadena have no idea that a stone's throw away from the fast lane is a lush but tiny Eden, a 4,000 square foot farm. It not only feeds a family, but revolutionizes the idea of what can be done in a very unlikely place, the middle of a city.
It says city living, but about the country to the city.
Uh-huh.
President have to go out to the country. It's just imported.
63-year-old Jules Gervais started this backyard farm 10 years ago. It's a deliberate throwback to the storied days of self-reliant rural America. Jules and his children grow almost all the food they need when pitches in.
5 pounds of grapefruit.
His daughters, Anise.
We have another guy coming to pick up.
And Jordan.
Yeah, are you done?
Okay.
And his son, Justin. Their produce is organic. And their animals are, well, friendlier than average.
Say hi. Say hi.
We have eight chickens, 4 ducks, and 2 goats. I joke with people because I think my animals fit better in a city backyard than a lot of dogs in the neighborhood.
The ducks and chickens lay thousands of eggs a year and keep the bugs in check.
It really made the dynamics of urban homestead much more sustainable.
Sustainable and dense. On their 4,000 square feet, they raise 400 varieties of vegetables, fruits, and edible flowers. 6,000 pounds a year, enough to feed themselves with plenty left over. And with the current passion at high-end restaurants for local pesticide-free produce, chefs are literally beating a path to their door.
Hi, how are you?
Hello, good. How are you doing?
We have your order for today.
Oh, wonderful.
Soil. So what are you going to do with the soil?
I'm going to use it to make a really nice relish with cucumber for a salmon dish.
The family makes about $20,000 a year from their front porch sales. They use it to buy the crops they can't grow, like wheat, rice, and oats.
I would say at the beginning, I didn't really believe I could do it. I had some doubts because I kept thinking, this place is too small. There's no way that we're going to be able to feed ourselves. Plus, I never thought we could even grow the vegetables for the market.
So how did this experiment in independent living begin? It all began 10 years ago when Jules bought some taco shells for dinner. He learned too late that the shells were being recalled because they had been made by mistake with genetically modified corn.
When I thought about putting this food in my children's mouth, and they were depending on me to give them good stuff. I mean, they'll take whatever their parent, any child would take what a parent hands them. They'll say, this comes from my mom or dad. And I couldn't afford to be in that position of giving them bad stuff.
Now, a decade later, this radical foodie has succeeded in going off the grid. He calls his lifestyle the path to freedom.
And what did family think of that whole approach?
They thought it was strange. They thought it was my daughter wouldn't come out of the front yard and visit with her friends because they said, what's up with your dad? They wanted to know what was going on because I was making some radical changes here.
The Gervais have no ugly commute. They avoid office politics and will never get fired. But their jobs are way more than 9 to 5.
I need the help, all the help I can get. And it's my family that, like in the old days, the farmer's family made the difference.
Jordan takes care of the animals.
A joke for them, and we call them pet organic composting machines.
Justin is in charge of making sure they get the most out of every square foot of soil. And sometimes the results are extraordinary.
You actually grew this?
Yeah, it's like a little pumpkin, but it's very long.
Just slightly.
He's also the beekeeper. Oh my gosh, that's the first time we've done straight from honeycomb. Mmm. Jules prides himself on his gourmet compost.
Oh, yummy, yummy. Only worms could love them.
Could love them.
LeBron's stuff.
Anise is in charge of cooking the vegetarian meals.
All homegrown, strawberries and triple flowers and salad and beets and carrots.
And the canning.
We got grape leaves, pickles, beans, and pickled peppers, to all sorts of jams, tomato sauce.
And the menu? That depends on what's in season.
What happens when something's out of season?
We just don't eat it. You're out of luck. It's out of season.
There are no microwave ovens in this kitchen, and no Cuisinarts either.
We have, you know, gizmos, but they're just hand power.
What little electricity they use is generated by these solar panels.
How much is your electricity bill?
Well, it's running about the highest $12 a month.
$12 a month for everything here.
They spend even less on gas. This is their biodiesel brewing station.
So this is just used grease from restaurants.
Yeah, they use it to fry onion rings, french fries, you know, anything you would fry.
And you get it free?
Yeah, free and delivered on their doorstep.
The gasoline station is self-serve. It hasn't always been easy. Justin remembers the year that frost wiped out a crop. Another year, it was a destructive insect. And recently, they've noticed a new challenge, climate change.
We call it the forefront of global weirding, because we've been gardening for so long, you can sense things are off. We have this June bug that comes out. It's called June, so it's supposed to come out in June, but it comes out in July and August. September, so something's definitely off.
The other challenge is water. Southern California skies don't deliver enough of it. So Jules keeps the water bill down with this ancient form of irrigation.
That's sort of clay pot irrigation.
So it's buried over there.
It's buried usually up to the throat here. Uh-huh. And then all you do is fill it up, and the water weeps through the pores, through the clay. And you get the water where the plants need it at the root zone. Plants take the water as needed. So simple.
So we'll let them have their dinner. But I think you can see some of the principles of agroecology even applied here in a U.S. urban setting. The self-reliance, the focus on local, adaptable systems, the innovation, both using traditional practices as well as newer appropriate technologies, and the empowerment of people that comes along with this. So we have a few moments for questions, and feel free to write those right into your screen in the question box. But we can go ahead and start off with a question from Charles Johnson, who is asking about the issue of waste, the great amount of food that's wasted, from a third to 40%, much of that at the consumer end, but also at the smallholder farmer end as well. And on the large farms. So he asks about, you know, possible solutions being to support farmers in granaries and small-scale storage to help prevent that kind of loss. Eric, I know you've traveled around a lot seeing farmers, small-scale infrastructure. How would you respond to this issue of storage and how that might affect really help the farmers and help prevent waste?
Sure. I just want to point out first, before that, that the industrial system, because it is a capitalist system, is designed to produce waste, because it's designed to overproduce. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you know, what's to be done with all this overproduction? It gets sopped up in different things. Some of it goes to agrofuels, a lot of it now has developed the whole seed market and whatnot, but it inherently has to overproduce, even when you go into the supermarket. Much of what you see on the fresh produce shelf is there just for the image. A lot of that just gets thrown out. So in terms of So that's inherently a wasteful system in terms of the food. In terms of production and small farmers, you know, the biggest problem is, you know, rats, really, around the world. And that's pretty easily solved with small storage facilities or with a larger system like they used to have in Mexico, Conasupo, where the government actually bought the grain from the farmers, from the ejido farmers, at a guaranteed price, and so they were glad to bring their grain in, and they stored them in very large granaries and were careful to make sure it didn't spoil. Those types of projects, especially the small-scale projects, you know, a lot of times you have these storage facilities made out of tin, and farmers get a small loan, and or they go to a workshop and they learn how to make these things, or not. That's all great, but these things, these technologies also break down when there is no social support to the countryside. When the social wage in the countryside is very, very low. In other words, when you don't have health, education, and welfare services in the countryside, where the countryside is basically a bad place to live, which it is for most of the smallholders in the world, these technological solutions just can't address these larger problems. And even the problem of waste and the infrastructure needed just to get these facilities out to smallholders and whatnot, if that doesn't exist, if smallholders are expected to pay so much of the cost for these type of facilities rather than having them simply be provided for by the state, then they end up not being a very good solution, which is why you end up getting a lot of loss at the farm level.
Great. If we can do one more question and hopefully a quick answer. The question is from Joaquin, how do we address the issue of increasing an inappropriate use of agrochemicals to boost production in sub-Saharan Africa? He talks about the long-term damage to the soil structure and nutrient content. Eventually, how do we restore the soil further from its depleted state?
Shall I address this as well?
Yeah, please.
Sure. Well, there are a number of agroecological alternatives, you know, that actually build soil and conserve water. I was in Burkina Faso earlier this year, and they had this this eye system. You know, it appears to be flat land, and it's savanna. But people are grazing and growing crops, and extremely dry environment. So I say it appears to be flat, a small slope. So they make small ridges in the form of little squares, and all across the with hose. And in the middle, they grow up a small hole, and they put compost in. It's a small depression, and then a little hole, and then they put compost in, and that's where they plant the seeds. And it's usually sorghum, millet, and beans, and they plant it there, and then so whatever rain does fall stays put and infiltrates into the soil. And over time, that part of the soil, that middle of the square, begins to build up more and more better soil tills and higher organic matter content and whatnot. And it'll get you through the dry periods. So it's very drought resistant. It's a strategy for drought resistance. All those things are great. There are dozens and dozens of these types of very simple things which farmers can do. But the problem is that it's the government that comes in and subsidizes fertilizer, which is what they did in Malawi, for example. Many farmers will just take the fertilizer. The government doesn't subsidize, unfortunately, doesn't subsidize the building, you know, making compost, doesn't subsidize agroecological methods, because there's no direct monetary return, right? So subsidizing fertilizer means that the fertilizer company gets a monetary return. If you subsidize compost heaps, no company gets any return. All of that value stays with the farmer. So that's why these things tend not to be pursued by Green Revolution institutions. So I think on one hand, what you have to do is reduce or remove the support, the tremendous subsidies that the Green Revolution receives directly and indirectly, and we have to begin to support much more directly the agroecological methods.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Eric. So yeah, we can move to Diana. Diana, go ahead. Well, I guess we'll switch to your screen so you can see your slides. And then hopefully we'll have a couple minutes at the end for some more question and answer. Great.
Can everyone hear me now? Yes? Okay. Hi, so I'm Diana with the Food Chain Workers Alliance, which is a national coalition of worker centers, unions, and food justice groups who are advocating for workers along the food chain. And one of the reasons that the alliance formed was there was so much interest in food, where it came from, how it's grown, and how the animals were treated, but missing from that conversation were the people who were behind bringing that food to our tables, the farm workers, the workers who work in meat, poultry, and food processing facilities. So this alliance formed to bring attention to that. So currently, the Food Chain Workers Alliance is made up of 24 organizations that are directly organizing workers in the food chain. And these are just the logos for the organizations. So in 2012, we released a report entitled The Hands That Feed Us that really looked at workers throughout the food chain here in the United States, the conditions they faced, and the opportunities for improvement within their different sectors of the food chain. So that report focused on the five sectors that we define of the food chain, which is production, farm workers, food, meat, and poultry processing workers, distribution, which encompasses warehouse workers, food service and restaurant, and also retail, which is your grocery stores. So from that, we found that there's 20 million workers in the food system in the United States. So it's one of the largest, it's the largest employer in the U.S., the food system. We found, although it's the largest employer in the U.S., the most of the jobs in the food system pay low wages. In addition to that, there's a lot of health and safety issues and concerns. And we also found that 79% of the workers that we surveyed did not have paid sick days or access to paid sick days. And in the, you know, sad irony, we find that food workers use public assistance programs at a higher rate than other workers. You can see here they use food stamps at a higher rate than other workers in other industries. And a third of food workers report to be food insecure, meaning that they themselves can't afford to eat. And that's something that Eric referred to, which is a big problem throughout the food system, where people who are providing us with food can't eat themselves, can't afford to eat themselves. So these are some of the facts of how our food system exists right now in the U.S. I also wanted to share some good news about how workers in the food system are coming together to make changes to the food system and improve conditions in the food system. So here we see these are workers, retail workers that work at Walmart, and they've come together to build an organization called Our Walmart, you know, Walmart's the largest retailer in the world and has a huge impact. They have a big market share of their grocery industry, and they continue to grow. And they've had been a major player in wages and working conditions for workers throughout the supply chain, just because they're such a big giant that they really set the standard for what prices are paid to suppliers, and that in turn impacts workplaces. So actually, these workers here from our Walmart have had two recent victories where they were able to get a policy where pregnant women, women who had pregnancies with complications were able to have their positions changed, also have access to drinking water and things like that, which was something that some workers were actually fired for when they had difficult pregnancies and they asked for changes in their work. We've all seen the strikes with the fast food workers who are demanding higher pay and the right to organize into a union. So we see that happening across the country, and workers taking a stand against these large corporations who really are controlling our food system. We also have the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, who are based in Florida and pick most of the country's tomatoes. And so here they've been able to have agreements with large corporations like Walmart, McDonald's, and Taco Bell to put in place a fair food agreement, which gives workers, farm workers, a penny more per pound. They pick buckets 32 pounds or more. And so now a penny more is given to the workers. In addition to that, there was a lot of sexual harassment that took place in the fields. Workers didn't have access to shade, and a lot of workers sometimes suffered from physical and verbal abuse. But now there's a process where workers can make complaints, and sexual harassment in that area has really been reduced, and it's almost non-existent, and it's due to the Fair Food Program that the Coalition of Immokalee Workers worked on. We also see there's workers in the restaurant industry who are organizing as well. Workers in the restaurant industry, it's one of the 7 out of the 10 worst paying jobs in the United States. In addition to that, restaurant workers also suffer from food insecurity at a higher rate than other workers. And so we see workers who are organizing in Darden Restaurants, which is one of the largest restaurant groups just in the U.S. with over 1,900 restaurants, such as Olive Garden, Capital Grille, Longhorn Steakhouse. So the workers there are organizing for higher wages. Right now, the national wage for workers who earn tips is $2.13, and that is what some workers at these Darden restaurants earn. In addition to that, they don't have access to paid sick days and things like that. So workers there are organizing, and they had some victory in getting the attention of shareholders and being able to possibly meet with the board members and try to implement some changes throughout the restaurant chains. And then here we have some of our member groups that are creating alternatives. The Farm Worker Association of Florida is a farm worker group, and they've been able to start community gardens and also instill the practice of agroecology. So that's an exciting thing, because they have also experienced that they're the people who are picking oranges and different crops, but they themselves didn't have access to healthy foods in their neighborhoods. So they thought this would be a solution for them to be able to provide their own communities with healthy foods that are pesticide-free and grown in a good way. We also have an ally in Cincinnati. It's a union food co-op. It's called Our Harvest. And what they've done is built a supply chain from the farm to the store, where all the everything's local and organic. And in addition to that, the workers at the store and on the farms are unionized into a union where they have representation and benefits. And then we also have another partner we work with, which is the Agricultural Justice Project, which works on a certification called Food Justice Certified. And what they do is they certify organic farms, but also certify farms based on their labor practices. So this is a way of combining two things that sometimes aren't really binded together, really looking at, yes, we want good food, but also we need to ensure that the people who are providing with us with this food are treated fairly. And then I'll end with something that you all can get involved in. So this every week, every year, we have a week of action, which is called Food Workers Week. So it's during Thanksgiving, and it's to bring attention to some of the struggles that food workers face and for people to get involved and know how they can support. And this year, we're releasing a comic book about food workers called Food Chain Avengers. So here on the poster, you see these are some of the characters in the comic book, and these are some of the themes for that week of action, which I can share more information afterwards, or you could visit our website at foodchainworkers.org. Thanks.
Thank you, Diana. That was great. So yeah, you've seen kind of the whole range of levels of the food system, from someone's backyard to a workplace to a national alliance of different workers working in the food chain, and gotten the global picture from Eric, and some mention of how peasant groups are resisting the industrial model and building the alternatives. So, you know, the key really, given the amount of the dominance of the system and the momentum that it has, is building our own power. And I think the Food Chain Workers Alliance is a great example of that. But they need everybody's support and engagement. And it's going to take all of us supporting these various efforts at different levels, wherever your passion and wherever you can plug in. To make the shift that we need for a sustainable and just system. So you can raise your hand if you've got a question or a short comment, or write in your question. And yeah, welcome any comments from the presenter while we're waiting for questions if people are not raising their hands.
Andrew, I'm not sure if you saw the question that Lydia asked of Eric, and she was curious if he's aware of either at the national level or a more regional level policy, or what has successfully shifted policies and politics to support small-scale holders, and what happened in order for that shift to begin, and what those steps look like.
United States?
I believe so. She says national or local.
Well, you know, I mean, the Farm Bill has some very small programs which sometimes get their appropriations and sometimes not, for beginning farmers and ranchers and minority ranchers and farmers. The problem with these, there's a few of them, the different ones. The problem is that, you know, there's not enough of them. There's not enough money. And, you know, these are projects, basically. It's a little bit of financing to implement and help practices and kind of help get people going. But these aren't the big rules. You know, I mean, the big structural rules which determine agriculture and which provide a tremendous advantage to industrial agriculture. Basically, we always keep smallholders and small family farmers at a disadvantage. I mean, just for example, the fact that big ag doesn't pay for the externalities, doesn't pay for the water it pollutes, doesn't pay for the greenhouse gases it emits, and doesn't pay for its risks. I mean, these are inherently very risky businesses that get bailed out by the taxpayer, either through subsidies or through the new insurance program. These provide advantages, just overwhelming advantages to big ag. So while it's important to take advantage of the small projects, and there isn't enough money to go around, but people try anyway, with apply and try and get some funding. These will always be sort of, at best, sustainable islands in a big, unsustainable sea of industrial ag. If we really want to connect those dots and turn them from being the alternative into the norm, we've got to change the big rules.
Diana, don't know if you have any comments on that question.
No, I think Eric answered it very eloquently.
I'd just like to also say, you know, that most small farmers I know and most beginning farmers that I know are just struggling to get by. And it's very difficult to see how they're going to be able to, you know, how a young family is going to be able to establish a family, send their kids to school, set aside for retirement, you know, basically lead a good life. I mean, even out here in California, a lot of farmers producing the wonderful, you know, fresh fruits and vegetables that we have out here, they're living in tents out in the field. I mean, we have to make the markets work against this kind of agriculture. So that means we have to make a social decision, political decision, to support this agriculture. Otherwise, in the long run, I don't see how it's going to compete.
All right. Looks like there are no more questions. Vicki, any closing thoughts? You mentioned that we're at the beginning of the Food Week of Action, joining with folks around the globe in this week that surrounds the World Food Day. And yeah, please go to, if you're on Facebook, you can join the events page about the Food Week of Action and get some daily action opportunities.
And I would just say also continue following you know, these people who are doing really great things in these groups that are, you know, working on these great initiatives. And you know, it's really great to be have these presented before us. So keep watching out for them.